Hello, and today we are with Mr. Peter Foster, OBE, President and CEO of Air Astana here in Kazakhstan. Good afternoon to you, Peter.
Good afternoon, Stephen.
Now, before we get into the airline, there is something very exciting we have to talk about. And I have to say congratulations to you, because you have just literally last week visited Buckingham Palace. Why did you go? Tell us a little bit more about this experience, please.
Well, it was a great experience. It was a great surprise. I was told late last year by the British Embassy here that I was to receive an OBE. I wasn't, of course, allowed to breathe a word of it on pain of losing it until New Year's Eve, but it was very exciting. It was awarded for services to British aviation in Kazakhstan. Indeed, yes, I had the tremendous opportunity of going to pick it up from Prince Charles last Friday on the 12th of June, which was the day before his mother's birthday celebrations, of course. It was all very exciting and very enjoyable.
Of course, not many of us will ever have the experience of going to Buckingham Palace, never mind picking up an OBE. Could you just tell us a little bit about the experience from when you arrived at the palace through to when you left? Just to give us a little taste of what it was like.
Well, that's right. I think we British can honestly and immodestly say that we do celebrations of this nature extremely well. And the whole ceremony was conducted sort of with tremendous elegance and what I would call understated style. It was sort of low-key in the most elegant way. It was extremely informative. His Highness talked to everybody individually and was genuinely interested and informed as to what everybody had done, why everybody was there. And of course, it was a great experience as well for the families. I had my wife and two children there, and it was a great experience for them too. So we all thoroughly enjoyed it. It was carried off by all of the palace staff, many of whom are ex, or indeed serving military officers. It was carried off with the greatest precision that one can possibly imagine, and it was a thoroughly enjoyable day.
What an experience. So they are going to be memories to cherish forever, I'd imagine, for
indeed.
The entire family, dear me.
Oh, indeed, absolutely. Yeah, very special.
Now, what is exciting as well, of course, is Air Astana and Air Astana's future here in Kazakhstan. It's a beautiful country, a lot of potential. You are currently flying within Asia Pacific to Hong Kong, Bangkok and Kuala Lumpur as well. What plans do you have for the Asia Pacific markets, and which of those are working better than others? How is it going for you?
Well, Asia Pacific is very important to us. We're a member, of course. We're the newest member of the Association of Asia Pacific Airlines. We joined last year. We've had operations to Thailand, to Bangkok for many, many years now. Latterly, we've added flights to Kuala Lumpur, Ho Chi Minh City, Hong Kong. We also have a strong presence in China. We fly to both Beijing and Urumqi in Western China. And we fly to Seoul in co-chair with ASEAN. So we already have a strong presence in both Southeast Asia and North Asia. We expect that to grow as the Kazakhstan economy grows and therefore is a source of outbound leisure and business travel. And we hope also for an increasing amount of business and leisure travel in from Asia. So we would expect to grow all of the existing destinations. And we also expect to add in the future flights to Japan and to Singapore.
For Singapore and Japan, what sort of time frame are we looking at, and what aircraft would you utilize?
Probably 2017. The 767 will comfortably make both Japan and Singapore from Almaty and from Astana. So that's the time frame that we're working on at the moment.
Singapore is a very important market, as well as Japan as well. In terms of the frequency, what sort of frequency are you looking for those two routes?
We would look to be starting off with not less than three frequencies a week. And obviously, it would be helpful to us if we could strike commercial agreements with local carriers. We're speaking to some of the Japanese carriers. We will be engaging with Singapore Airlines as well.
Do you have any expansion plans on the routes that you currently have, such as Bangkok and the others that you mentioned, such as Hong Kong, or any other changes?
Yes, Bangkok. We operate daily flights to Bangkok from Almaty. This winter, we operated a winter seasonal flight from Astana to Bangkok. That will be reintroduced in October, and that will be round the year, so that'll be year-round. So that'll become a regular year-round service as opposed to a seasonal flight. We've just added we've added a third service to between Almaty and Seoul, again in co-chair with ASEAN. We've just inaugurated a new flight between Astana and Seoul, again in co-chair with Asiana. We have just added an extra service from Astana to Beijing. So, you know, we're continuing to add capacity on our Asia-Pacific routes.
For the Hong Kong sector, how is that going? And, with regards to Astana and Almaty, how is that going to change?
Well, Hong Kong, you know, Hong Kong is a business destination primarily, as far as outbound is concerned. The links are growing between Hong Kong and Kazakhstan. We would like to see more leisure business from Hong Kong into Kazakhstan. We believe that there is potential not just for Kazakhstan, but also onto our what we call our extended home market. So, you know, to destinations in the Caucasus, other destinations in Russia, and elsewhere. So since we are continuing to develop the Astana hub, it is likely that we will switch the triangular pattern of the flight to operate Hong Kong to Almaty via Astana and vice versa. So the international segment, if you like, would become Astana Hong Kong, but the flight, of course, would continue on to Almaty and originate from Almaty. So there would be still a good service to and from Almaty, to and from Hong Kong.
In terms of the Asia-Pacific market there, in terms of Bangkok and KL, why do you feel that Bangkok is so successful?
I think Bangkok is an extremely popular tourist destination. Primarily, it is driven by outbound tourists, not just from Kazakhstan, but from all of our regional markets. Thailand has traditionally marketed itself very effectively in this region. It is very popular. It provides, you know, the type of holiday experience that people from this region are looking for, particularly in the northern winter.
In terms of Kazakhstan as a destination, talking about inbound now, what do you feel that it offers to the Asia-Pacific markets that in terms of attractions to get them in for tourism rather than just for business?
Well, the potential is absolutely vast. I mean, Kazakhstan, obviously, I think as most people know, Kazakhstan has a remarkable geography. It is vast, it is varied, we have spectacular mountains, spectacular natural attractions for tourists. But I think beyond that, Kazakhstan is, of course, a very central part of the old Silk Road, the old trade routes between Western China, China, and the Caucasus, and through to Europe. And therefore, we have a significant cultural heritage that can be seen to this day. That's primarily in the south and the centre of the country, which we fly to. That's very interesting. Also, Kazakhstan has a very strong and vibrant modern culture. Almaty, in particular, is a cultural centre. There is a tremendous amount of music, of art, of cultural activities and entertainment of all types. It's a city that likes to play as hard as it works. So it's an enjoyable place to be, as well as a very interesting place to be. So Kazakhstan has a vast amount to offer the international tourist, and we hope that will become developed as time goes on.
How important is visa facilitation? Just not a couple of years ago, Kazakhstan allowed countries such as the UK to come to Kazakhstan without the need for a visa. How is this, as the vehicle by which they enter the country, have you seen increases in those markets where there is, and how important is this in long-term development?
It's very important, of course. It is very important. Obviously, it removes an inconvenience of travel. If you don't need a visa, then of course you don't have to go through that process at foreign embassies in order to get a visa. Not that visas were difficult to get in the first place, frankly, but it's still a process, and if you don't have to do it, then obviously it's easier. Of course, it's only one relatively small element of the whole tourist mix, which comprises so many other things, of course. And the key, obviously, is English-speaking facilities on the ground and high standards of ground services for tourists. And that is something that is developing. It needs to develop further for Kazakhstan to be a world-class destination. It needs to develop further, but it is developing very rapidly. And, of course, the other element is the promotion of the country as a tourist destination, and not... it hasn't been a national economic priority up until this point. That is set to change, and we expect that the resources will be deployed accordingly.
Now, of course, we've just had the Paris Air Show. You made a major announcement there. Could you tell us what will you be doing with the aircraft that you've just ordered, and also with the Boeing Dreamliner? What are your plans for those two different aircraft types that you have?
Well, the A321 long range, you're right, we're a launch customer of the A321 long range. That's the 97-ton ACT aircraft that will enable that aircraft to operate up to 4,000 miles. We expect to deploy that on all of the routes on which we currently deploy our Boeing 757s, which will be retired at that time. They will all be 20 years old by that time, 2019, and therefore they will be retired. They will be replaced by the 321 long range. The 787, we expect the 787 to operate some ultra long routes, such as, for example, New York, but also the existing routes on which we operate. And we expect that the 787's operating economics will enable those existing routes to become to become more profitable than they are at the moment.
Of course, with the new aircraft comes new interiors. What are some of the exciting new interiors that you have planned for these two aircraft?
Well, the 767, which we brought in, we bought some of the last 767s off the line from Boeing last year, so those cabins really are very much a sort of prototype, if you like, of what we intend to put on the 787s. They have the Thomson Aero, what was the Contour business class seat. It really is one of the best seats, I think, in business class, long haul business class cabins today. The economy seats as well are the slim fit, very comfortable seats. In-flight entertainment, it's the Rave system, which is again one of the pioneering IFE systems that's presently available on the market. The other element that we'll be introducing will be connectivity. Of course, we have to wait and see which way connectivity is going. There is an increasing sort of race to the bottom in terms of pricing of connectivity. Then, of course, service providers will become cheaper, and connectivity itself become cheaper for airlines. So that's the other big element. But really, we don't expect to see a vast difference from our present 767 cabins, which really are of a very, very high standard and have been extremely well received by the market.
In terms of costing is one factor as well. We all like to see miles, and being part of an alliance not only helps in terms of connectivity and people to earn their own miles, but it also helps in terms of the promotion of the airline and the country itself. What are your thoughts on alliances, and do you have any plans to join an alliance?
Well, the point about alliance strategy is that alliances are particularly useful when you're sourcing a lot of travel from a very wide number of geographical points. Take Europe, for example. We fly to London, Paris, Frankfurt, and Amsterdam. But of course, that doesn't mean to say that all businesses that are doing business in Kazakhstan and Central Asia are all based in London, Paris, Frankfurt, and Amsterdam. They're not, of course. They are based in cities all across Europe. And clearly, if one is in partnership with one or more European airlines, then one has a far greater market penetration into the other cities across the continent. Increasingly, the same is applying to Asia as well. So the absolute sort of key, if you like, to any form of alliance or partnership strategy is market penetration. And it's on that basis that we will take a decision.
Within the world, there's different segments of low-cost carriers. Air Asia is very successful in the Asia-Pacific region, Ryanair, etc., etc. What are your thoughts on this? And do you, as an airline, have any plans to launch a low-cost carrier?
Air Astana operates, we take the view that the arguments with regard to the different airline models have rather moved on. Low-cost airlines, as we remember, came very much to the forefront in the wake of September the 11th, when it was clear that a lot of legacy carriers had accumulated by that stage a very, very, very high legacy costs in terms of low utilization of aircraft, low utilization of flight crews, and very high pension costs, for example. and low-cost airlines came along starting from scratch with a much more efficient operation. Of course, in the wake of that terrible tragedy, they were, if you like, able to take advantage of the market really being thrown into a period of enormous chaos and turmoil at that terrible time. Since then, of course, legacy carriers have become themselves much more efficient, as we have seen right across the world, but particularly with airlines such as, for example, British Airways and the US carriers. And we see the other European carriers, of course, tackling this issue at the moment to a greater or lesser extent. Air Astana, of course, is very fortunate. We started operation in 2002, and therefore we were able to start the airline on the basis of an extremely efficient operation from the very start. And therefore today we would contend that Air Astana is already a low cost airline in the sense that our costs, our unit costs are some of the lowest in the industry. So we don't, what we do not expect to do is to launch a no-frills operation. We believe that we can operate at a cost that it is significantly lower than other full-service airlines, even some low-cost airlines, some, if you like, traditional low-cost airlines. We believe, and indeed we can, operate a full-service product at a cost that allows us to sell that product in the market at an extremely attractive price. We do not believe that stripping a certain number of aircraft out of the fleet and taking out business class and compressing the cabin into one large economy class at a sort of 2018 seat pitch is going to bring any value whatsoever to the airline. What it will do, of course, is reduce efficiencies from economies of scale. It will be a descaling process, which obviously would be illogical. Therefore, we have no intention of doing that whatsoever.
And finally, for my last question, Kazakhstan is going to have a high-speed true rail network in the future. This is something that's expanding throughout the world, high-speed rail. Is this a threat to airlines such as yourself?
No, I don't think so. I mean, high-speed rail, railways are always going to be cheaper than airlines. High-speed rail, of course, reduces the differential between rail costs and airline costs. Therefore, necessarily, the railways will also be targeted at the sort of the lower end segments of the airline business. It's not a market that we play in particularly aggressively in any event. I mean, we are in every market, of course, and we have to be in every market. But there is a market segment that we limit ourselves to carrying. Certainly, we don't eliminate it. So we don't see really the railways a threat at all. Quite the reverse, in fact. We see transportation links in general in Kazakhstan getting better. That attracts more people to Kazakhstan, it attracts more investment to Kazakhstan, more tourists to Kazakhstan, and everybody benefits. So actually we are very pleased to see the developments that are taking place with the railways, which actually is undergoing a huge amount of positive change at this time.
Well, on that positive note, Peter, I have to say thank you very much indeed for your time today. And of course, congratulations once again on the OBE. And I wish you, of course, and Air Astana the best of luck for the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen.